Does anyone have any questions about stuff we covered in the first half of behavioral? Is it starting to make a little bit more sense with like the simulation, kind of what you've covered in class with Professor Austin and here? Any discrepancies you're finding or anything? You're kind of like, well, she said this, but then you say this. So which one is it? Like any questions like that? Those are good questions to bring up because, again, it's not that any one person is wrong or right. You're going to find that lots of different people have different ways to skin these proverbial cats. I recommend not skinning your patients, though. They do not like that. They like to keep their skins where they're at. Anywho. All right, let's continue on. We're going to talk about antipsychotics, something that probably you feel like most of your professors should be on, at least to some degree, right? We have lots of delusions of grandeur, like you guys actually want to hear us talk for hours at a time. Anywho, so why do people develop schizophrenia? Too much dopamine? That's one thought. You might have multiple thoughts. Maybe there's... We'll see. The pathogenesis is going to be a little bit more complicated than that. And that'll be evident when we look at the different types of drugs we're going to use to treat. But you've covered schizophrenia already, correct? And so there's lots of things that go into this. There's probably a genetic component. Like you definitely find that patients who have first degree relatives with schizophrenia tend to have that run in the family. So that is, again, a big risk there. There's probably some other causes, again, that we're still continuing to elucidate. I'm not going to get super in-depth on that. But just know that in general, one of the big things we're thinking about is dopaminergic transmission, right? So we'll look at some other neurotransmitters that are going to be important here as well. But dopamine is one we always think about because the primary set of drugs we had for a good long time were drugs that block dopamine, essentially. So we said, okay, well, if we give them drugs that block dopamine, this helps with some of their symptoms. And how do you kind of divvy up the symptoms with schizophrenia? There's positive symptoms, right? So there's stuff that's there that shouldn't be there. What else? There's negative symptoms, so things that should be there are not there. And then there's kind of a third set. It's kind of like a cognitive set of symptoms. We'll look at those in just a second. So, and that'll be important because when you're looking at treating those different types of symptoms, you're going to find that by affecting these neurotransmitters can have different effects on these. And so that's why we'll see there's a big difference between a lot of our first generation agents and to our second generation agents. But anywho, one of the big things we're seeing here is that we think there's probably some sort of dopamine receptor defect or there's too little or too much transmission depending on kind of where you're at within the brain itself. Some people feel that a lot of the cognitive and negative symptoms come about from having dopamine hypoactivity in the frontal cortex, right? And so you just said that, well, schizophrenia comes about from too much dopamine. Well, actually, there's probably dopamine hypoactivity in some areas, like we said, the frontal cortex here. And so that's important because you'll find that a lot of the first generation antipsychotics we had don't actually help a whole lot with the negative symptoms. They really help more with the positive symptoms, but not the negative. And we think we probably see more of the positive symptoms here due to this dopamine receptor hyperactivity, so too much dopamine happening here in the mesocotyl. So just be aware that there's probably different sources for these different symptoms and that the drugs are going to work differently based on kind of what the actual underlying issue is, or at least what we've come up with as our best guess at this point, right? Glutamate is going to be important here as well. We're going to find that glutamate hypoactivity can actually stimulate some dopamine activity, so that can actually exacerbate some of these issues here. And this may be causing some of the cognitive and negative symptoms we're going to talk about. And then also serotonin is going to be big, because again, what's the primary difference between your first generation and your second generation antipsychotics? You see that serotonin is going to be a big component of the second generation, the atypical antipsychotics. Serotonin blocking effects are going to be really big with that one. So that's important to keep in mind. We'll talk about that in just a second here. But they believe there's probably hyperactivity in that frontal cortex, and that actually inhibits dopamine release. Okay, so you're like, well, this is a bunch of gobbledygook. I'll try to show it at least in pictorial form. And this is also complicated, but I'll try to just keep it simplified to our purposes for the drugs we're going to use for these patients. So anyway, imagine you have these dopaminergic neurons are going to be having different projections out to different parts of the brain, right? And so basically one of the big things you're seeing here is we're having too much activity. I wish my cursor would go to the pen. Stand by, technical difficulties. I'm getting a little blue circle-y thing of death, so I'm hoping that doesn't cut out on me. Anywho, if we're imagining, see these this first projection kind of heading down, that's in the nucleus accumbens. That's where we're seeing a lot of dopamine hyperactivity. This is where we're probably seeing a lot of these positive symptoms. And what are some examples of positive symptoms? Like right here, we're talking about these guys here. Yeah, hallucinations, delusions. Do they get more like visual or auditory hallucinations? It can depend, yeah, but usually, at least like a lot of the patients that we see, because we see them kind of in these acute kind of psychotic episodes, especially in the ER sort of setting, they see a lot of auditory hallucinations. This is what we see in a lot of cases. But again, it can depend on the patient a lot in some situations. But we're thinking we have too much dopamine activity here. So this is where we're seeing a lot of our positive symptoms kind of starting to develop. And we're also having here in the frontal cortex, we're probably having dopamine hypoactivities. We're actually seeing kind of a negative effect overall. And that can actually be important because, again, looking at serotonin here, serotonin actually has an inhibitory effect. That's why that negative is right there. So if I have too much serotonin activity, this is going to do what to dopamine release? So too much serotonin activity is inhibiting this neuron, which have decreased dopamine release. Okay, so again, that's where you're starting to see some of that being important. So having too much serotonin in the frontal cortex is causing less dopamine to being released. And that's where we're seeing some of these negative symptoms and some of these cognitive effects are happening here. This is also very important for because with some of these circuits, they get, again, a little more complicated. This one is typically right here. This is a negative, it's an inhibitory sort of neuron. So if I have less dopamine activity being sent out from the frontal cortex, so less dopamine activating this receptor here, you know, I don't want the laser pointer, but less dopamine activity activating those receptors, guess what? Now this is going to have, this is basically taking the brakes off of the nucleus accumbens, and then again, that's going to increase further more dopamine release. Okay, so again, you can see how this is kind of a little bit of a cyclic kind of activity here. So basically, nucleus accumbens think too much dopamine activity, think it's positive symptoms, think frontal cortex, too much serotonin, too little dopamine is where you're getting the negative symptoms and where you're getting the cognitive effects. Okay, keep that in mind. It'll be important to talk about the drugs. Positive symptoms are going to be this and the nucleus accumbens and the mesocaudate. Yeah. Okay. So basically, our presentation, as you might imagine, again, some of your professors might experience some of this. You're going to find they'll kind of lose touch with the reality. They'll kind of create these kind of false realities for themselves. We mentioned, you know, hallucinations, a lot of hearing voices, those delusions, ideas of influence. And then you'll find that their affect tends to be pretty flat. This is where you get some of these negative symptoms here. It can be kind of inappropriate, can be pretty labile in a lot of situations, especially when they're kind of these acute sort of phases here. Other things, like, you know, personal hygiene suffers, is very difficult for them to keep a job. You find there's a lot of kind of social aspects that kind of go into this as well. Also, as you might imagine, if these patients are having these like delusions or having these hallucinations or telling them you're fine, you don't need to take any of these medications, how do you think compliance is going to be with these? Not great, right? Compliance is always going to be a big issue with these patients, and that's when we oftentimes see them, like in the emergency room setting, is they'll be taking their medication, things are going good, all of a sudden they decide they don't want to take them anymore, they'll have an acute episode, and then come in to see us, and then we'll have to treat them kind of from an acute kind of aggressive sort of standpoint. So we'll look at some differences there, but we see a lot of relapsing, hospitalization due to this poor compliance. This is where also we're going to see a lot of IM formulations of drugs can be very useful, especially if they're long-acting forms. So there's some Haldol formulation. You guys heard of Haldol before? It's kind of a very prototypical first-generation antipsychotic used for a long time. They actually have depot forms that gets formulated into kind of an oil base, goes into the muscle, and they can release the drug over the course of several months. That way, you're kind of have forced compliance for those patients, which can be beneficial for some. Anyway, we also find that there's a high rate of substance abuse with these patients. So oftentimes there's concomitant ethanol use, which can be further kind of clouding your symptoms there. And then nicotine use is pretty big here as well. And it was kind of interesting. I was reading a source that was saying that, you know, they think that the reason why a lot of these schizophrenic patients smoke so kind of almost like compulsory is because there is a fundamental lack of nicotinic activations happening in the brain in some form, way, shape, or form. So they're actually trying to correct that by intaking this nicotine. So I thought it was kind of interesting. So there's probably a lot of neurotransmitters, a lot of stuff we don't know about this, just similar to depression and bipolar disorder. But again, we're kind of working off of these theories. Going off the drugs, or we know what the drugs are doing specifically, and we're seeing that they're effective for some of these symptoms. Anyway, so we mentioned the positive symptoms. So again, things that are there that should not be there. So we've already alluded to hallucinations, suspiciousness, you know, paranoid thoughts, things like that. The negative symptoms are going to be more that kind of that flat affect they have. Anyone know what aloja is? They're really able to like, come up with like the right words to express themselves. Anhedonia, what is that? That was also my goth rock metal band that I had in high school. That was a pretty cool name. Yeah, so they lose the kind of lack of pleasure in things they would normally find, you know, pleasurable. Avolition, they may not be able to like kind of act on these thoughts that they're having, things like that. And then obviously the cognitive symptoms that go kind of hand in hand with the negative symptoms. Kind of think that frontal cortex kind of affects there. We have impaired memory, attention. They're not really learning from their mistakes very well. They're not making really kind of appropriate decisions and things like that. So anyway. So our goal here, we're going to find that pharmacotherapy is going to be the cornerstone for therapy for these patients, and you really want to be more assertive in kind of the first 5 years. So the earlier you can kind of catch it, kind of make this diagnosis. And again, is there any kind of test we can do to test for this? No, you really have to go off the symptoms that the patient's presenting with. You know, you may find some patients are at higher risk due to having first degree relatives that may kind of key you in, but a lot of times you're kind of going off of, you know, you're getting these first episodes that are occurring sometimes in the ER, and that's sometimes the first times we're catching it. But you're going to find that they're going to have the most deterioration kind of early on, and so this is when we want to be kind of most assertive with our therapy, and it really needs to be individualized. So some patients are going to have more positive symptoms than negative, and vice versa. So you want to be able to try to target that as best you can. And again, try to give up to at least 3 months before you really kind of assess kind of the full-time effects here. And compliance is going to be a big issue. Patient education is going to be huge, but you need to really give it time to see how these drugs are going to work for the patient overall. And again, we saw that, you know, with SSRI, certainly there's side effects that you're worried about, you know, but these drugs are going to be much, much more laden with many side effects we're going to see. And not only just things like, you know, cognitive impairment, but you're going to see a lot of metabolic effects as well when we get into some of these. So we like to minimize adverse effects as best we can. We like to decrease hospitalization, obviously, because this helps improve their quality of life, cuts down on costs, obviously. And then if we can achieve the best compliance, you know, by either using proper dosage forms like iron administration, like I mentioned, things like that. And then obviously minimize costs as best we can. There's a lot of new agents that are starting to come out. This is kind of as, especially the second generation of the psychotics, the atypicals. You're seeing a lot of new versions of these drugs that are starting to come out, kind of like how when we came out the first, you know, ACE inhibitors, a ton of ACE inhibitors came out after that. This is kind of a similar thing we're seeing here. Because again, are we just using these antipsychotics for people's schizophrenia? No, we're using for all sorts of other things. We're starting to use them as add-on for like treatment-resistant depression. We're starting to use them for bipolar disorder. We're starting to see them used for all sorts of different. In fact, I'm even starting to see like Abilify has an indication or being used for like ADHD. So lots of different places you're going to see these being used than just for people with schizophrenia. So you want to be familiar with them because you're going to see it being used. So looking at the first generation antipsychotics, anyone know any examples of first generation? Halidol is a big one. Risperdal is actually not, it's actually an atypical. Has anyone ever seen the movie A Beautiful Mind with Russell Crowe? That one's really kind of cool. He was on Thorazine for a lot, so we'll look at some of these different ones. But these are the ones that are really, really side effect prone. We'll not use these as often as we're using the atypicals now, but it's important to have some experience with these, at least you have some familiarity, because you're still going to use them occasionally here. But basically, these are working primarily by blocking D2 receptors. They are blocking D2 receptors. These are going to be mainly effective for those positive symptoms. These are the big things. And these are why these are also really good for kind of those acute kind of psychotic episodes, because if they're coming in having lots of hallucinations or becoming very aggressive, these drugs are really good for helping to deal with those kind of acute positive symptoms, and then you can kind of transition them over to something else. So this is where you're going to see a lot of activity for these drugs, and you're starting to see fewer people being put on these for the long term, and we'll see why that is. Anyone know why we don't use these for the long term for a lot of our patients? Any like main side effect that you see with like long term use from these drugs? Yeah, tardive dyskinesia is going to be a big thing we'll talk about. So we'll talk about why that is in just a little bit later. But I think tardive dyskinesia is a big reason why we don't use these drugs long term. The first generation antipsychotics. The second generation, you're going to find much less risk for tardive dyskinesia. So anywho, again, imagine if we are blocking these dopamine receptors here. Even if we have a whole lot of hyperactivity causing a lot of dopamine to be released, we're still blocking those receptors and overall decreasing the activity there. So again, that can decrease those positive symptoms. Imagine what disease state do we talk about where we had decreased dopamine activity? Parkinson's, right? So basically you're going to find these drugs, some of the symptoms they can induce are going to be Parkinson-like effects. So keep that in mind. They cause dopamine blockade. They're going to cause Parkinson-like effects due to having hypoactivity of dopamine. Okay. Why these pictures always goof up my presentations, but any questions so far? I'll wait for my computer to wake up. I can run the hottest games at great detail and great frame rate, but little picture in my PowerPoint slows it to a halt. Anyway. Okay, so we're going to find that there's lots of side effects associated with these drugs. And so one of the big things you're going to find is that similar to how we said, you know, when you have a decrease in the amount of dopamine activity, you kind of have an increase in acetylcholine activity. like we saw with Parkinson's patients, right? That's where they get that kind of that resting tremor at. You're going to find that another kind of seesaw effect you have here is between dopamine and prolactin. You guys talked about those side effects you see with these drugs yet? So that's a big thing. So you end up having increased prolactin release associated with these dopamine blockers. Again, these are the first generation of psychotics we're focusing on right now. So big things you're going to find, gynecomastia, especially in your male patients. You're going to have menstrual irregularities that can happen in some of your female patients that can, you know, affect ovulation, may make it difficult for them to conceive, and all kinds of other, you may have, you know, all kinds of issues due to that increased levels of prolactin. So kind of keep that in mind. Again, I mentioned having a dopamine antagonist, you're going to have increased acetylcholine effects there. So you may end up seeing some of that tremor that can develop from that. So again, another reason why I don't use this in the long term. And then one of the main limiting factors we're going to run into are these EPS symptoms, the extrapyramidal side effects. These are those Parkinson's-like symptoms I mentioned that you can develop from these. Now, you're going to find that this is going to be related specifically to how much dopamine specificity these drugs have. And you're going to find there's going to be kind of a scale here of how potent they are at blocking dopamine versus how potent they are at dealing with some of the other receptors. Because we're going to find that a lot of these first-generation agents are going to be, again, very similar to like the tricyclics. Now, they're kind of dirty and they kind of affected lots of different types of receptors. Same thing's going to happen here. But the more dopamine blockade you have, the more potent these drugs are at blocking dopamine, the more likely you are to see these EPS symptoms, okay? And so again, this is mainly from dopamine blockade and that caudate putamen. Again, go back to your Parkinson's lectures, you'll see kind of where we're talking about that. But again, they're going to have that motor rigidity, they're going to have that tremor, a lot of us do the acetylcholine effects, catatonia in some cases. And so you're also going to have this dystonia that can occur here as well, and you have a lot of involuntary muscle contractions, usually like the face, the neck, the tongue. I always remember this one really good case one of my attendings had in, when I was in fellowship, and they said that there's this family who they, I guess, you know, the family that does drugs together, sticks together, I don't know, but they all decided to buy some Valium from off the street, right? And this is like years ago. And so they all decided to go buy this Valium, and they took this Valium, and then all of a sudden they had these like acute dystonias. And they got brought into the ER because they didn't know what the heck was going on. They thought they took Valium. They thought they took diazepam, you know, benzodiazepine. Should not cause dystonias. And then what they realized, they had some of the pills left over. So they actually looked at it, and they did it through a pill identification system. And they basically found that the diazepam tablets that they thought they were getting looked almost identical to haloperidol tablets. So they thought, you know, this drug dealer, I guess, was trying to get one over on them and said, okay, yeah, here's the Valium. They actually ended up getting a bunch of haloperidol. We're going to look how you treat that in just a second, but those are very common things you see, especially with big doses of Haldol, these really potent dopamine 2 receptor blockers. So again, keep that in mind as being kind of a hallmark side effect of these first generation antipsychotics. You also end up having that akathisia that occurs here. So we kind of talked about it a little bit with the SSRIs, but I see this quite frequently with people who are getting things like haloperidol. They get that kind of pacing, that shuffling. They're just, you know, really not comfortable in their own skin kind of feel there. So that's another common side effect you're going to see with these dopamine 2 blockers here. And then we mentioned on the long-term standpoint, you're going to have this tardive dyskinesia. Okay. Basically, what we're seeing by chronically blocking dopamine receptors, you actually lead to these receptor upregulations, right? That kind of makes sense based on what we talked about in pharmacodynamics, where if I block those receptors, they're going to upregulate in response to that. Because again, they're going to want to have more dopamine activity than what they're getting currently. So basically, they get upregulated, they get more sensitive, and so you end up seeing these effects that happen over the long term. So this is like, you know, years that patients are on these drugs for, they start to develop this tardive dyskinesia. And so they get these like kind of chewing, these licking movements that occur, and again, this is all involuntary, these tongue protrusions, and you're going to find that in a lot of cases, these are not reversible side effects, right? These are things that once it happens, the changes in those dopamine receptors are irreversible. And so you're going to find this is also not treated like a dystonia. We're going to find that the treatment for that is specifically is going to be because the issues are different here, right? With the dystonias we're seeing due to dopamine receptor blockade, here we're actually having too much dopamine activity. They get very sensitive. And so the treatment's going to be very, very different from that standpoint. So this is the big reason why we don't use this long term. But again, the question is like, you know, do I have to, you know, leave them with all these positive symptoms and they're not really able to function socially, or do they get the start of dyskinesia? For a long time, they were having to kind of balance that out, and it really wasn't good for the patient overall. And that's why we're kind of getting around a lot of this with the atypicals that we have nowadays. Okay. So other effects you can see, kind of ancillary effects, not related directly to its mechanism for schizophrenia, but you can see some alpha-1 antagonism. So you can see a lot of postural hypotension, some dizziness associated with that. You're also going to see a lot of anti-muscarinic effects. We already talked about the mnemonic for that, right? What's the mnemonic for anti-muscarinic effects? Mad as a hatter, hot as a hair, dry as a bone, red as a beet. What's the other one? Blind as a bat, right? So again, remember those effects. Now, on the other hand, you will find that the anti-muscarinic effects are actually good for the Parkinson's-like effect. So again, and have you guys covered in with Professor Austin, how do you treat an acute dystonia due to one of these typical antipsychotics? You actually will get Benadryl. So we'll talk about that in a little bit later and why we do that. But Benadryl, again, blocks acetylcholine. So again, if I have an atypical, or one of these typical antipsychotics blocking dopamine, I'm having an increased acetylcholine effects. If I can get something to block that, it'll actually help to inhibit those kind of extrapyramidal side effects. So I'll talk about this when we get to the specific drugs here in just a few minutes. But if one of these drugs has more anti-muscarinic effects, you kind of lose those extrapyramidal symptoms, okay? The more potent that these drugs are for the dopamine receptors, the more extrapyramidal symptoms we're going to see. Yes, sir?
I'm sorry, maybe I'm a little confused. Mm-hmm. I thought you said before that there's more acetylcholine, so wouldn't that be not necessarily anti-muscarinic? Wouldn't that be
right, so what you're seeing is with these agents, due to the dopamine blocking effects, that will cause a secondary increase in release of acetylcholine just in the scene. It's not like peripherally done, so you don't see like the diarrhea and the urination, things like that. However, as a ancillary effect these drugs will have, they will actually block some of those receptors as well, those acetylcholine receptors, and help to mitigate those side effects. And so we're going to look at the actual drugs here in a second. We'll look at them kind of on a gradation from how potent they are blocking dopamine receptors. It'll make more sense when we get to the specific drugs, okay? We talk about the actual side effects. You're going to see some histamine receptor antagonism. This is going to lead to a lot of sedation. So a lot of these antipsychotics are very, very sedating, okay? Good if you have a patient who's having an acute psychotic episode and you need, you know, they're a danger to themselves or others, you want to knock them down. So I don't know if anyone's ever seen or heard of vitamin H. You have a patient come in acutely psychotic, you give them a little vitamin H intramuscularly, they go down for the count, right? Nice because it doesn't help, block their respiratory drive, but they are now sedate. You can actually, you know, do things like put restraints on them or get an IV started, whatever you need to do. That is something where you give Haldol, vitamin H is kind of where we get that from. Anyway, some weight gain associated with this. So again, you can see dyslipidemia, diabetes can be worse, and they can have some glucose resistance. So again, you're going to find metabolic effects. This is for the long-term sort of issues. Again, other issues we're running into with these patients, you know, another reason why we don't like these drugs as well for kind of long-term use. And then some cardiac effects. In general, you're going to find that most of these can prolong the QT interval. Okay, we know that puts you at risk for torsades, right? And so again, typically when these drugs are used in therapeutic doses by themselves, you're not going to see a huge increase in QTC. However, if we start to mix them with other drugs that can do that, you're going to start to run into some issues. Okay, so again, in overdose, we run into this problem. In having multiple drugs that prolong QTC, this is where you run into issues. You also end up seeing some tachycardia due to the anti-muscarinic effects there. And also some of them might have sodium channel blockade, which will predispose them to some ventricular arrhythmias due to blocking a repolarization of the ventricles, essentially. So again, a lot of cardiac effects. This is more primarily seen with multiple drugs on board or if you have an overdose that occurs. So, and anyone ever heard of neuroleptic malignant syndrome? NMS. How would you describe NMS? It's a malignant syndrome. Neuroleptic. No. So neuroleptic is another term for these typical antipsychotics. So if you're hearing neuroleptic, that's kind of what they're referring to. Basically, and it kind of when you're thinking about these psych meds, you kind of think of serotonin syndrome and NMS. They look very similar to one another. NMS tends to be a lot more severe in regards to some of the actual physiologic effects you're going to see here. The big things you're going to see are going to be this kind of muscular rigidity that occurs. They get very, very tight. They're not able to relax their muscles at all. And they're going to find that rhabdomyolysis is going to happen here. A lot of heat gets generated, so they get very hot, hyperthermic. You can have kidney failure secondary, that myoglobin clogging up the kidneys. It can be very, very severe. So again, you have to be very careful with this, and you're going to see this more likely to occur with high potency D2 blockers. We'll talk about some examples of those in just a minute here, but the two big ones you're going to think about are going to be haloperidol and then flufenazine. Okay, so two big ones we'll see here in just a second. It can really occur with any agent that's blocking those D2 receptors, but it tends to be more likely to occur with those kind of high potency blockers there. So I mentioned ultramental status, hypertension, hyperthermia, and that lead pipe rigidity. So again, they get very acidotic, they get very hot, and they have the muscle breakdown related to that. It's really kind of interesting because you're just like, just relax your muscles, and they just can't, like, they're just kind of locked in like that, very, very tight, and it's can be potentially very dangerous. So we'll talk about some treatment for that a little bit later. But now, if you remember, if you think back to serotonin syndrome, or some of the signs and symptoms associated with that. Hyperthermia, altered mental status, you have autonomic instability, and the big differentiator here is you're going to find that they get the lead pipe rigidity. You don't really see that much kind of tightening up of a patient with serotonin syndrome. They get more like increased clonus, like in the lower extremities, things like that. So typically NMS you think of being much more kind of severe. But again, you need to go back and look at their med list to be like, well, okay, well, which one is it? You know, were they on an antipsychotic drug? Were they on an SSRI? And try to delineate which kind of issues you're trying to deal with. Because we saw that for serotonin syndrome, you want to use like a serotonin blocking drug, like cyproheptadine. Here, what do you think we'd use instead? So the primary problem is blocking dopamine 2 receptors. What could we give to overcome that? Give a dopamine agonist, right? So we talked about a drug called bromocriptine before. That would be the thing you could use to reverse that, because it actually will try to kick off the blockers and actually activate the dopamine receptors. So the ones in yellow I put here, because again, there's a lot of these. These are all the first generation, the typical antipsychotics. And I try to put them in, I guess I didn't really put them in that good order. But anywho, the yellow ones are the ones I want you to be familiar with and at least could identify for testing purposes. And so you'll notice here that they kind of get broken down into their different receptor antagonism potencies, okay? So you're going to find that things like flufenazine and haloperidol tend to be very, very potent at blocking the effects of dopamine, right? So this is where you see more of those extrapyramidal side effects. You're going to see more of that Parkinson's-like effects. You're more likely to see neuroleptic malignant syndrome. On the other hand, you get something like prochlorperazine, which actually we use sometimes for migraines, but compazine or chlorpromazine, which is the brand name there is Thorazine. This tends to be much more potent at blocking muscarinic receptors, those alpha receptors, histamine. And so what's nice is you actually have less extrapyramidal side effects because they're really not dealing as much with the D2 receptors. Again, you think schizophrenia, you think too much dopamine activity. That's not the full story. So again, you're going to have multiple neurotransmitters being utilized here. But that kind of makes sense. So the more potent a dopamine 2 receptor blocker you have, the more likely you are to see EPS, those Parkinson's symptoms, more tardive dyskinesia associated with that. So keep that in mind. As you get less potent agents, you're less likely to see some of those side effects. But as you might imagine, with something like chlorpromazine, more likely to see a lot of hypotension associated with that, much more anti-muscarinic kind of effects. Okay. So again, don't memorize specifically you know, how many pluses are in each of these columns. But I would know that, you know, haloperidol, flufenazine, those are the big, really potent dopamine 2 receptor blockers. So if you were to have someone have NMS, it's going to be more likely due to haloperidol, flufenazine. Okay. Could happen with any of them, but those are the two big ones. Here is another table that will go into not necessarily like the receptor activity itself, but more specifically the type of side effects you're expected to see here. And this one does a better job of looking at like high potency versus kind of low potency agents. So again, chlorpromazine, you see a lot more sedation associated with that. They have more moderate to low sort of EPS symptoms. That's those extrapyramidal side effects. You know, have more anticholinergic effects, more orthostasis. You can see seizures that can occur in some of these patients. This is more with overdose or patients who have kind of a seizure history. So it's not something that you see too commonly, but again, you're going to see more kind of weight gain associated with these, more prolactin levels being increased versus your high potency agents, a lot more EPS, relatively low anticholinergic effects, you know, but a lot of EPS associated with those because again, they're just more potent at blocking dopamine 2 receptors. We'll talk about the atypicals here in just a few minutes, but kind of keep that in the back of your mind as we'll get to these in a little bit. Okay, so again, first generation agents are very effective for positive symptoms, but a lot of the side effects lead to discontinuation. And we mentioned that the tardive dyskinesia is a big thing over the long term, over years, is going to be problematic for a lot of these patients, okay? Because again, it's not something you can necessarily reverse just by discontinuing the drug, unfortunately. Again, we'll select the agent based on symptomatology. So if they're having a ton of like really bad positive symptoms, a more potent dopamine 2 receptor blocker is going to be better for them versus something like a chlorpromazine, which is a little less potent. Yeah, so again, you're just kind of basing off symptomatology, but again, these are starting to go by the wayside a little bit and to make way for kind of the atypicals, which we'll talk about here next. Okay, so as far as treatment for the side effects go, for the EPS symptoms, so these dystonic reactions, those akathisia, you know, that patients, those patients I mentioned that came in, they thought they were getting street Valium, but they actually had the Haldol instead. The thing you can do with that, because again, you're blocking dopamine, so you're getting more acetylcholine activity, you can give them an anticholinergic, which is usually, you know, you see the most commonly in those first generation antihistamines. And so this is where it gets something like diphenhydramine or Benadryl, or pure anticholinergics, you'd see trihexphenidyl and then benztropine. So if you're here, some getting like Cogentin, For kinesia, that's what it's being used for, is an anticholinergic, right? So, and you'll see this occasionally. So we actually ran into some issues where, I remember one call in particular when I was during fellowship, where we had a kid who, has anyone heard of the term episotonus? That's a fancy word. If you look it up, you'll find a picture where basically they get this really bad back arching that occurs. It's very, very uncomfortable, very painful for the patient. And it can happen sometimes with these dystonias. And so we actually had an infant who had gotten into mom's, again, this is not mother of the year kind of material here, but she basically said, I don't want to deal with this baby anymore. I'm going to go into my room, lock the door, and just let them have, you know, run of the house. And they got into mom's antipsychotic agent. And so it was one of these high potency agents. And so the kid got into it, took a pill, an adult dose, and basically had this like really bad back arching. Kid was screaming, very, very severe dystonia that was happening secondary to this. And so what we ended up giving was benztropine, and that will actually help to relieve that effect. It'll help to relax those muscles, and you actually give it to them for about 24 or 48 hours until the drug kind of wears off, the antipsychotic does, and then kind of back to normal. So again, think about dystonias, treat it with an anticholinergic. These are the three big ones we'll use most commonly, right? Occasionally you can also use benzodiazepines because, you know, these can act as kind of general CNS depressants, but it also acts as kind of muscle relaxants. So you may see them being used occasionally as well. So I think for that kid, we also gave probably a dose of Ativan or something to help kind of relax the muscles and kind of relieve some of that pain issues that the patient was experiencing. Okay. For the tardive dyskinesia, again, the issue here is not dopamine receptor blockade. It's actually that hypersensitivity of the dopamine receptor. So you can't treat these effects with an anticholinergic because it actually will end up making them worse. Okay, so your job, if you had a patient who was having this, you have to determine, is it like a dystonia or dyskinesia they're having, or is it more the start of dyskinesia? And a lot of it has to do with duration of use, right? So they've been on a typical agent, they've been on it for years, it's more likely to be the start of dyskinesia here. Oftentimes what we'll either do is discontinue therapy to prevent it from getting worse. Sometimes we'll go what we have called drug holidays. It's not like where you go somewhere to do a bunch of drugs, that's where you take a break off of your drugs that you're taking currently, right? You guys shouldn't have drug holidays, those are bad. Go to Amsterdam or something, and don't do it. Anywho, the big thing you're going to see is that second generation agents are going to circumvent this in a big way. So since those have come out, they've the tardive dyskinesia risk is much lower, and so these are going to be much better agents to use. So we'll talk about the second generations in just a minute here. Okay, for NMS, if you did have a patient who's experiencing this, so they come into the ER and they have this lead pipe rigidity and their fevers, you know, 106, and they're, having this ultramental status, all these things, you obviously discontinue the offending agent. But imagine if someone, we mentioned the Haldol that you can use as an intramuscular injection, it's there for like 3 months. Imagine if you injected that, all of a sudden the patient develops NMS, how easy is it to get rid of that drug at that point? Impossible. Can't even get that out. There's been cases where people have injected on purpose large doses of insulin subcutaneously, and there's been cases where we've actually done like sub-Q removal. We've actually just kind of excised the area, but you can't really do that with the muscle. So unfortunately, that drug, once it's there, it's kind of there. But you want to cool the patient down the best you can. So again, it's where a lot of like, you know, cool IV fluids, you can use evaporative cooling methods, all that cool the patient down, obviously hydrate them, try to keep that myoglobin from clogging up the kidney. And we actually have another drug called dantrolene. This one has nothing to do with dopamine necessarily, but you may see this one used for another condition called malignant hyperthermia. Anyone ever heard of that? You hear it a lot in association with surgery and with general anesthesia. It's another common place you'll see that. But this is actually working as this kind of peripheral muscle relaxant. So that actually helps you relax the muscles, will help to prevent some of that breakdown that's occurring or try to stymie it a little bit. And hopefully you bring the temperature down. So again, that'll be something you'll see. And again, most hospitals, especially in the OR or the ER, they're going to have malignant hyperthermia carts. Because again, this is a medical emergency. So dantrolene has to be available if those patients have kind of a bad reaction. We'll talk more about this in the surgery section, but just kind of get you familiar with the drug now. And then I mentioned that bromocriptine is a dopamine receptor agonist. So basically, it just kind of tries to kick whatever the receptor blocker is off and then allow for dopamine transmission to occur again. So that's one way we can try to treat that. Okay, so this is a good table, kind of going back to looking at, you know, when you might expect these different side effects to occur, how we can manage them. And so you kind of refer back to this. We kind of covered all this already. So again, if you have any questions, just let me know. This is kind of a good kind of study tool for some of these things. Okay, so then moving on, we have our atypical antipsychotics. You're going to find that these are going to differ a lot in their receptor activity. You're going to find there's a lot less potency at blocking dopamine 2 receptors. However, they're also going to have a lot more serotonin blocking ability. So we mentioned too much serotonin activity inhibiting dopamine release in the frontal cortex. This is aimed to help with that. these atypical antipsychotics. So again, fewer extrapyramidal effects, less prolactin level increases. So again, it's good to help mitigate some of those side effects. You're going to find much more efficacy for the negative and cognitive symptoms. Okay, so you're having someone has like really an acute episode, acute hallucinations and these delusions, things like that. Maybe like a typical agent is better for that kind of acute run, but these are going to be better for kind of long-term management for a lot of these patients. Less tardive dyskinesia, the risk is much, much lower. So the patients can be on this for much longer periods of time, really have no big issues from that standpoint. And really should be first line unless they have some other contraindication to receiving them. Okay, so things schizophrenia, think atypicals nowadays. Okay, so I mentioned much less affinity for D2 receptors in that striatal tract. However, we're going to see some activity of blocking D3 and D4 receptors that tends to also lessen the EPS symptoms, which is beneficial. And with these 5-HT2 receptor antagonisms, the big differentiator here, this is what's going to help out in the frontal cortex, right? So blocking serotonin 2 receptors, that's going to allow for more dopamine to be released and allow for kind of to treatment those negative effects, those cognitive sort of effects. Again, working more specifically here versus working here, blocking the dopamine receptors there. And again, that makes sense that they will have some effect on positive symptoms as well, because if I'm blocking serotonin here, I'm going to have more dopamine release. This is going to make this neuron more active, which is inhibitory in nature, and it's going to, again, feed back and cut down on the dopamine release in the nucleus accumbens. That kind of makes sense? So by working kind of more frontally, it's able to still help out with the nucleus accumbens over dopamine activity. It won't be as potent for treating positive symptoms, but it can still help. Okay, so adverse effects. Again, these drugs have a lot of adverse effects associated with them. A lot of times they're going to be more metabolic in nature than anything else. And so you're going to find that there's a lot of weight gain associated with these. I mean, this is something where patients will put on 30, 40, 50 pounds, like no problem, right? You're going to find this most often with olanzapine. That's most common one. I'll give you a table here in just a second. I'll have the brain names and everything. And clozapine are the other big ones, okay? You typically see the lowest amount of weight gain associated with ziprasidone and aripiprazole. Anyone know the brand name for aripiprazole? That's your Abilify. This is the one you're kind of seeing as being kind of like the weakest out of the bunch, but it's also being used for kind of the most kind of off-label uses. So this is oftentimes one you're going to see being used for like in addition to SSRIs for depression treatment, adding on for like ADHD. So you're going to see a lot of Abilify being used out there for lots of other conditions and simply just schizophrenia. But it's one of the things where you want to watch their weight at baseline, monitor it, over the course of several months. If they have more than a 5% weight gain, probably need to stop that drug and try to switch them over to something else. But I've seen patients who like they really only respond to olanzapine, and so it's kind of like, okay, well, do I like have a normal functioning kind of life, or do I deal with the weight gain? Oftentimes, it's more beneficial for them to try to manage the weight gain with exercise and diet, and still have that kind of normal psychosocial functioning for them. So you can also find some glucose intolerance associated with this. So some patients will develop type 2 diabetes in response to taking these drugs, especially clozapine is a big one. And then hyperlipidemia can be worsened here as well. So a lot of metabolic effects. Again, they will have to either switch off to try a different drug if it becomes too much, or try to mitigate with exercise and diet and whatnot. Another kind of unique thing is clozapine is kind of interesting. This one has a black box warning on it for agranulocytosis. Okay, this is one of those things we have to monitor. And again, you remember those REMS programs I mentioned previously with like Accutane, where the patient and the provider and the pharmacist has to all be signed up with the program. Clozapine cannot be used unless you sign up for these programs and have the patient register, because you have to monitor CBCs quite regularly. And so this is one that you do not want to use unless patient has kind of failed multiple other agents. It's kind of the agent of last resort in a lot of cases due to the increased monitoring associated with and this risk for agranulocytosis, right? Very careful with this one. You have to monitor white counts even weekly, especially up front, and then maybe you can space them out a little bit, but again, it's very, very important to monitor for this appropriately. You'll still see QT interval prolongation with a lot of these agents. Again, this is more important in overdose or if you have multiple agents on board that do this, but it is still a theoretical concern. And then we mentioned the orthostatic hypotension. You see this a lot with a lot of IV and IM doses. So especially for those patients who are acutely kind of aggressive coming in, if you give them like a dose of like IM Geodon or something like that, that is more likely to see this kind of orthostasis. So again, they might be dizzy, more likely to fall. And elderly patients tend to be more at risk for this as well. Okay. You can get some tolerance that will develop over time, but it takes a few months for the patient to kind of really get used to it. Now, there is another black box warning kind of associated with all of these atypical antipsychotics. You want to avoid these in elderly patients with dementia-related psychosis, right? So even though you're having these patients, and I've ever seen like, or heard of sundowning, know what that is. This is something I'm kind of familiar with working in the hospital setting. What is sundowning? Crazy after dark, which is explains my my party scene, right? Just kidding, no. I do not party. Explains my children last night. I will say that much. Sun goes down, all of a sudden they go crazy. Yes, ma'am. I'd have to double check on the typical antipsychotics, but you see, because these are starting to become used much more commonly, and again, these are good agents to like sedate patients. So again, if you have someone who's like, you know, your grandpa gets admitted to the hospital, son goes down, he's in an unfamiliar place, he starts to go kind of crazy, sometimes they can get a little aggressive. They're very likely to use, you know, some of these atypicals like Geodon or something, just give him an IM shot and it kind of knocks him down for the night, right? This is where you're starting to see some increased mortality associated with them. So I'm much more familiar with the atypicals. I have to double check to see if it goes for any of the first generations. Yep. So be careful in elderly patients. If they're having dementia, don't want to treat it necessarily with these drugs because there has been a bit of mortality seen in studies. Again, I don't know the full mechanism for why. Maybe it has to do with cardiac issues. Maybe it has to do with who knows what. But they do see increased mortality, so you want to avoid using it in that patient population. Okay. Can I just mention, since I referenced my kids and these as an opportunity to talk about them, you know, is anyone familiar with the SpaceX news from yesterday? We were able to land two rockets simultaneously on the ground at the same time. We got a lot of technology on our side. However, my daughter was able to somehow pee out of her diaper without actually getting the diaper wet at all, my infant. I don't understand how this occurs, but diaper technology needs to catch up. I mean, astronauts have to use diapers. Something's got to happen. So what I would like to have given my children last night, we were watching Trolls for the third time, is some of these medications because it would have increased some sedation, right? So you can see it with any of these, but you'll see it especially with quetiapine, which is Seroquel, it's just a lot with olanzapine, clozapine. So very frequently, we will recommend these for QHS dosing. So that way, if they're going to be sleepy, like at least they're going to be at a time where they're going to be sleeping anyway. A lot of these will have anticholinergic effects. You can see a lot of dry mouth and constipation associated with them, especially clozapine or olanzapine. Olanzapine, again, is one of those things where you're going to see the most metabolic effects seen with it. You're going to see a lot of these additional side effects. But for some patients, it's the only drug that really works for them, unfortunately. So maybe an agent of, we have to kind of weigh the benefits versus the risk there. And then seizure risk is also a possibility. So we've run into this more commonly, like for overdose sort of setting where they have multiple meds on board that can cause seizures. So imagine if you had someone who was on, say, one of these atypical drugs for their schizophrenia. They're also on, you know, TCA for their depression, which can also cause seizures. You see a multiple meds when all added together increases that risk. The seizure threshold starts to lower and more likely for it to happen there. So you got to be careful with that. Okay. As far as general drug interactions, the main thing you're going to run into is going to be more pharmacodynamic interactions. So again, imagine if you have a patient who has schizophrenia, I'm treating them for that with like olanzapine, all of a sudden their blood pressure goes up due to these metabolic effects. And I might treat them with an antihypertensive. Antihypertensives tend to worsen. What about the blood pressure? It's a bad way to ask the question. So hypotension is going to be an issue, right? So postural hypotension, especially, this can worsen that, right? So if I have an antihypertensive on board plus this, you can see that kind of be synergistic. So think about those dynamic interactions rather than just purely kinetic interactions that are happening here. And then anytime you're mixing multiple dopamine blockers, you're going to see increased risk of EPS. So we'll talk more about metoclopramide and promethazine in the GI section. Anyone know what you use these two drugs for? Yeah, usually nausea and vomiting, but these share a lot of structural similarities that I've kind of alluded to previously with these earlier typical antipsychotics, the first generation agents. So if I'm mixing multiple dopamine blockers together, you will see some of these EPS symptoms that develop. And I remember talking to one hemonc pharmacist, and again, we know that talking about chemotherapy, one of the big side effects seen with that is what? Nausea, vomiting, right? And so it's a big thing. They would have to take, but this is before Zofran came out. They were taking these mega doses of metoclopramide or Reglan and to deal with the nausea and vomiting. They were developing these really bad EPS symptoms. Some of them were developing tardive dyskinesia, but it was like, it's either that or deal with this really kind of aggressive nausea, vomiting associated with, in who likes vomiting? No one does, right? So again, it's very miserable for them. So they were sometimes having to deal with that. So again, it's another reason why Zofran is such a good drug compared to some of these older agents. But multiple dopamine receptor blockers, you're going to see more risk for those symptoms. Okay, so this is another good table. This is kind of showing you the common atypical antipsychotics that are out there that are available. Again, aripiprazole is Abilify, and when you see very commonly used for lots of other kind of off-label uses. Clozapine, I mentioned, you do not want to use unless you have failed every other agent due to that agranulocytosis risk. We have, let's see, iloperidone, which is finasteride. This is a newer one. I don't have a ton of experience with this one. Ziprasidone. Or Geodon. I see this one being used more commonly now, at least from an emergency medicine standpoint, as an IM injection. So this is a good one that we have available as a parenteral product. You just inject IM, and that will help to knock out your patient, kind of sedate them, and kind of get them a little bit more manageable, especially when they're like acutely aggressive and kind of in danger to themselves or others. Paliperidone or Inviga, this is a new one I don't have a ton of experience with. Olanzapine or Zyprexa, this one you see a ton of metabolic effects with, so you're going to see a lot of weight gain. A lot of dyslipidemia, glucose intolerance. So again, be careful with olanzapine from that standpoint. Quetiapine or Seroquel, another very common one I'm sure a lot of you have heard of. Risperdal or Risperidone. And then these are two new ones I don't have a ton of experience with either, like acenapine and this Lurasidone. Again, you can kind of compare their different side effect profiles together. Again, I'm not going to ask you very specifically on a test necessarily, you know, which one of these has the worst you know, say sedation associated with it, and put like, you know, four different atypicals. I'm not going to get that granular with it, but just know as a general rule, like a lot of these are very sedating sort of medications. So if I put something like, you know, which one of these are most likely to cause sedation in a patient, I put like, you know, an SSRI, an SNRI, like an amphetamine used for ADHD, and then one of these drugs, you'd be able to select out, okay, it's probably going to be one of these antipsychotic agents. That kind of makes sense? Okay. Or I might actually put an individual drug, but you have to recognize that, hey, this is an atypical antipsychotic. Yes, I know that causes sedation. You know, kind of those kind of the questions I normally ask. Okay. And don't remember how many stars are in each box. It's a fool's errand. Don't want to do that. Some other agents, and again, these are relatively new ones. These are a lot, like, there's a lot of Me Too drugs that are coming out. A lot of companies are saying, hey, let's hop on this atypical bandwagon. Let's go ahead and get new drugs out. Again, these are very, very new ones that I don't have a ton of experience with, but, you know, your Seroquels, your Abilifys, your Risperdals, Zyprexas, those are the really common ones you're going to run into probably most commonly. And then, again, clozapine, be very careful with that one due to the agranulocytosis. All right, and kind of go back and compare the side effect profile with your atypicals back to your general kind of first generation antipsychotics. And again, these are probably the most common ones, as I mentioned, that I see most often. This is an older table, so that's why it doesn't include a lot of the newer ones, but this is probably the ones I'm most familiar with, probably the ones most likely to come up on a test if I had to guess. But again, look, a lot of sedation associated with that. I heard this one comedian, he was talking about, he was at his girlfriend's apartment, and they had these, like, guys are doing construction, like, in the middle of the night, downstairs, and he couldn't sleep at all, so his girlfriend's like, oh, here, take this, and it was a Seroquel, and he's like, okay, I'll fine, I'll take it, so he took it, and he actually, like, was going to the bathroom before he went to bed, and then, like, fell asleep standing up, peeing, and all of a sudden, he woke when he, you know, banged his head against the mirror or whatever it was next to him, and he's like, I gotta look this drug up, and he looks it up and saw it was an antipsychotic, and he's like, wait a second, my girlfriend's taking antipsychotic. Anywho, I'm not good to go through people's medicine cabinets. So you're going to find out a lot of stuff you don't want to know. But anywho, right, so just know they're very sedating, but very low risk for EPS symptoms, right? So you're not likely to see that because they're not really blocking dopamine 2 as its primary sort of mechanism there. You will see some anticholinergic effects. You will see some orthostasis and seizures, relatively low risk for the most part. Not a lot of prolactin elevations. That's really more seen with the first generation agents. So again, think about prolactin increases in first generation antipsychotics. And again, probably a little bit more weight gain associated with these agents, especially with clozapine and olanzapine to be the worst. Okay, so again, as far as monitoring goes, look for these metabolic effects and monitor the weight, again, at baseline and follow up, blood pressure, their fasting glucose, fasting lipids, A1C, if you want to check that, if you're worried about them, you know, kind of over the long term. And then again, look for this kind of other antipsychotic side effect. Let them know what to look for in terms of EPS symptoms, tardive dyskinesia. Just let them know what to look for so they can report back and may necessitate switching over to a different drug. Okay, so as far as acute treatment of acute schizophrenia, say they're coming into the ER, you know, they're having these positive symptoms. The big thing you want to do is try to decrease those positive symptoms first. In some cases, you may utilize things like a benzodiazepine to help kind of calm them down initially. So like an intramuscular dose of like, you know, Ativan or Versed or something like that will help to kind of knock them down a little bit, get them sedated, so that way you can kind of get them a little bit more manageable. But this is where things like, you know, haloperidol is very common when we use intramuscularly. I mentioned Geodon is another common one we're seeing used more intramuscularly nowadays. Again, the sedating effects help with those positive symptoms and get them a little bit more manageable. So again, you're going to titrate doses up as tolerated. So we want to try to use the lowest dose possible, obviously. And then if we don't see any improvement in symptoms, usually 3 or 4 weeks or so, you probably should switch over to something else. Again, they take a little bit longer than that to see really full effects, but by 3 or 4 weeks, you should see some improvements. But again, a lot of interpatient variability and response, similar to the SSRIs. Not everyone's going to respond to the same antipsychotic agent, right? I mentioned compliance issues. You can consider using like a long-acting form, like long-acting haloperidol, something like that. There's also from the second-generation agents, I'm going to find, you know, olanzapine, risperidone, ziprasidone, aripiprazole. All those have intramuscular variations that are available. Again, one injection, you're set for a few months, which can be beneficial. Now, would I want to start someone off on one of these kind of long-acting forms? No. Why not? Yeah, because if they have a bad reaction to it or they don't tolerate it very well, I can't do anything about it for the next few months, right? So you need to have them start on something orally. Once you know that kind of drug works for them, then you can consider switching them over to something like a long-acting form if compliance is a big issue for these patients, which very, very maybe. So keep that in mind, not the first thing to go with. Okay, just a kind of a good kind of flow chart, kind of going over the pharmacotherapy algorithm. Typically, you want to start off with an atypical agent, second generation agent, first line nowadays. Okay, so you can use something, especially if you have a treatment naive individual. Again, aripiprazole, risperidone, ziprasidone, those are all really good agents you can start. Olanzapine, I probably wouldn't go with first line, mainly due to, you know, kind of the weight gain effects and kind of negative metabolic effects. But any three of these would be totally fine to start with. And then you're kind of just monitoring for a response to therapy. So you can either switching over to a different drug, or you're titrating dose, whatever it happens to be. Again, avoid clozapine unless they have failed kind of really everything else for the most part. Let's see. Again, if they are having good response to an atypical agent, you can consider a long-acting form if, you know, compliance is an issue for those patients. So think about that. And again, think about other comorbid conditions. So if they have an underlying, you know, bipolar disorder or depression, or they have something else that could be influencing this, like you have to consider those as well, and because that can affect compliance, could affect other aspects of their lives. You need to treat that additionally, right? So always keep all those in mind. Okay, let's see. We mentioned as far as maintenance therapy goes, sometimes patients want to go on breaks from the medications. You have a drug holiday, that's totally fine. But you do want to have a discontinuation period over a period of a few weeks. You want to taper the dose down. And again, restart if they start to have kind of withdrawal, recurrence of like positive symptoms and things like that. You can go ahead and start off at a lower dose to try to help stave off those kind of withdrawal effects. And then I mentioned, you know, when you're switching agents, you typically don't want to stop someone cold turkey from one agent and switch them over to another one. You want to taper down off of one and kind of start up the other and titrate that dose up. Similar to how we saw with SSRIs and how, you know, you don't want to just like stop one day and then start the next one. You got to have to taper there. And this is just some of the withdrawal symptoms you can see from discontinuing these drugs abruptly. Insomnia, nightmares, things like that can certainly develop. Recurrence of positive symptoms is a big one you worry about additionally. Okay, so any questions on the antipsychotics? You can keep the side effects in mind. You're going to see them used for a lot of other indications. Like I said, Abilify, you'll see it used for ADHD. You'll see it used for depression. You'll see it used for all sorts of things. Just be familiar with the common side effects you're going to run into it. So again, if I had a question, we know the atypicals. We worry about which cardiac conduction abnormality? QT prolongation. And then you think back, okay, well, if I had to also be using this for depression, which SSRI might you not want to mix it with? So which SSRI had specific QT prolongation? Celexa and escitalopram, or Lexapro, right? So I think citalopram, escitalopram, those are the two big ones. At least as far as my lectures go, those are two big ones you're going to be concerned with. So again, that would be something where maybe I don't want to combine those two. Maybe I'll use fluoxetine instead than using citalopram if I have like one of these atypical antipsychotics on board, right? So those are kind of things you want to kind of think about when mixing and matching these drugs, because again, sometimes patients aren't going to take them like they're supposed to, and if they take a lot of them, that's where you're into a lot of these problems, and they have to come see people like me, right? You guys want to do a break now? Is that okay? No? You want to do lunch?
Yeah.
Hmm. I suppose. Okay, we'll come back in 12:30. How about that? Any questions from the first half about our antipsychotics? So this last half is begin. This, we're done with this slide set. This will be the end of material for then the test on Monday. I will not be here Monday. Just note that because that's my professional day. But actually, I'm rarely professional any day, really. But those are the days I work at Nemours. So I may not be able to validate the test that day. So you may have to wait a little bit to see if there's any givebacks or anything like that. So just keep that in mind. We tried to move the test to Mondays. So that way you could try to devote your entire weekend thinking of my fun, great lectures. Because the problem you run into is when you have a Monday, Wednesday, Friday test, Friday kind of takes short shrift. You guys' brains are fried by then, and grades tend to drop a little bit for that one. So I did read a joke on our brief break. Did you guys hear they arrested the world tongue twister champion? I imagine he'll get a tough sentence. Anyway, okay. Yes. And this is a good joke. I just had to read a joke. Okay. All right. So now let's talk about some anxiolytics. Let's bring it down, and then we'll do ADHD and bring it right back up with our stimulants here. Okay. So anyway, so we have lots of different anxiety disorders. I'm sure some people experience these right before, especially my farm test. Some of you may even develop some post-traumatic stress disorder after dealing with me, but that's okay. We have drugs for that. People are having these, anxiety is a good thing, right? In small amounts. It's kind of a good defense mechanism. However, we see these patients develop kind of these inappropriate responses, and a lot of it can be related back to our neurotransmitters. So things like regulation of norepinephrine, serotonin, but another big one we're going to see, especially for like acute panic issues, GABA is going to be a really big thing, right? Because again, GABA typically is inhibitory or excitatory. It's inhibitory, right? So again, if you're having someone who's really ramped up and they're anxious, try to bring them back down by increasing GABA activity. So we're going to see that's going to be important here as well. Again, there's probably some abnormalities in the HPA axis. I won't get too much into that, but there's probably some other things going on here. But we're going to primarily look at regulation of these neurotransmitters here. So certainly there's plenty of drugs themselves that can actually cause anxiety to occur. So we mentioned the antipsychotics causing akathisia, digoxin toxicity. Remember where we used digoxin? For arrhythmias, like what type of arrhythmias? AFib, yeah, typically AFib. What else do we use it for more commonly? Or CHF, remember how we use it for CHF for kind of some symptomatic management. Digoxin toxicity in high levels can sometimes induce some anxiety. Certainly any kind of stimulants or sympathomimetics can do this. So we'll look at a lot of stimulants in our ADHD drugs here a little ways from now. But yeah, stimulants can certainly induce this. Hallucinogens, anyone know any good hallucinogens? Asking for a friend. LSD, that's a good one. Yeah, so acid is LSD. There's ketamine, could be a hallucinogen. You can see, anyone ever heard of DMT or ayahuasca? Go look that one. There's some cool documentaries on Netflix about that one. Anywho, hallucinogens can do this. Anyone ever had or heard of someone having a bad trip? That's basically kind of what there can be, that anxiety associated with the use of those drugs. Things like stimulants, anticholinergics, drug withdrawal itself can also cause a lot of anxiety. So, someone who's used to having kind of a, something like a depressant effect around like alcohol, if you withdraw from that, that can actually have increased glutamate activity and cause some anxiety to happen there. You can see with opioids, you can see with benzos, lots of things can cause that kind of withdrawal syndrome. Anywho, we're going to find supportive therapy is typically the first line treatment. So again, try to calm them down, good supportive care, try to help them through it as best you can. But we're going to find from the pharmacotherapy standpoint, we'll look at both at chronic management and then also kind of more at acute anxiety. We'll also look at a few cases for like situational anxiety, things like performance anxiety, how we can use specific agents to treat the symptoms thereof. So we're going to find that for acute anxiety issues, typically benzodiazepines are a good drug of choice. So we'll get into more detail on those. Chronic management, antidepressants can be very useful for this. Again, the kind of the way that I've seen antidepressants being used, it kind of helps with dealing with, kind of everyone has, kind of peaks and valleys in their mood throughout the day. I feel like antidepressants kind of like just kind of level things out to a degree where you don't really feel as high of highs and as low of lows. And that helps to deal with some of those anxiety issues. And I mentioned depression goes hand in hand with anxiety. So again, you kind of get dual benefit from using these SSRIs. So we'll look at antidepressants from that standpoint. And then some alternative agents. Have you guys ever heard of buspirone or buspar? That's one that's kind of different in activity than a lot of the other agents we'll look at. And then rarely, we mentioned sometimes second-generation antipsychotics will sometimes be added on as adjunctive therapy if, like, an SSRI or antidepressant was not working well enough on its own, as we kind of alluded to in the antidepressant section. So we find that antidepressants, and again, this can refer to any of the ones that we've talked about. So SNRIs, SSRIs, TCAs, any of them can be useful for treatment of anxiety. And again, just we'll kind of refer back to generalized anxiety for the most part here. And they're good for long-term management of this. Again, if you're having like an acute panic attack, hyperventilating, they're kind of freaking out, like antidepressants not going to fix that immediately because, you know, SSRIs take time to kick in. It's better for more of that kind of long-term management. But some other ones that actually have true approvals, and again, a lot of these drugs are used off-label. There's nothing wrong with that. But you'll find things like venlafaxine, which is what type of drug? It's an SNRI, absolutely. There are Effexor, duloxetine, there's Cymbalta, you know, paroxetine, escitalopram. All of these are just fine agents. You want to typically avoid things like TCAs. So like imipramine is an example of this, can be a second line agent because of increased risk for side effects. We know that TCAs typically are more side effect prone. They have anti-muscarinic activity, antihistamine activity, anti-alpha activity. So lots of other side effects. You can avoid that. It's going to be beneficial for your patients. So SSRIs, SNRIs are going to be kind of your go-to drugs for kind of chronic maintenance of these anxiety issues. So, you know, we don't know the full mechanisms why these work, you know, is thought to help kind of modify the stress, you know, kind of adapting pathways. And again, they don't not going to be effective. They need to be taken for several weeks, need to be compliant with these in order for them to kick in. And we've already covered the adverse effects of all of those. We kind of reference back to that for, you know, a refresher. Now, on the other hand, drugs we've talked about briefly are going to be our benzodiazepines. Do you guys remember how benzos work? If you could describe it. They help to increase influx of chloride, right? So that's working, you know, that's helping these GABA channels to open up more because that's what allows actual chloride to flow in through. So again, look, if you notice like these GABA channels here, these are going to be made up of different subunits, and they're going to find that GABA will bind to one site on its own. So you see GABA here binding to the site. That's what allows for the actual opening up of those channels. Chloride flows in, and what does that do to the neuron? Hyperpolarizes, it makes it more difficult for an action potential to occur. So that's why you see that CNS depressant effect from increased GABA activity, right? Basically, you're going to find that the benzodiazepines have their own binding site, which you see here, and will help to facilitate GABA binding more readily, right? So it causes some sort of conformational change, will allow GABA to work more effectively. And so basically, you have that channel opening up more frequently than it would otherwise be happening. Barbiturates are doing a very similar thing. So like your phenobarbital is kind of doing a similar thing. But this is the main mechanism we're going to see the benzos. They don't directly open those channels, but they help GABA to work better. Okay. So the available agents we see here. So I think I highlighted these as yellow because these are the primary ones you're going to see being used from a parenteral standpoint. So if you needed something, IV, IM, something like that, these are kind of your go-to parenteral agents here. I remember why I started those as well. Sometimes you do these lectures enough years in a row and you're like, oh yeah, I remember why I did that. And then you forget. But then I just remember why I did that. So that's okay. Anyway, there's lots of benzodiazepines that are out there. You have things like alprazolam or Xanax. Anyone know the street name for Xanax? The cool kids would call it. Zanny bars. If you ever see a Xanax tablet, the random tablets actually come in these like little bars. You can actually kind of break off individual. If you want to do like a half tab or a quarter tab, you could actually do that. So yeah, the name Zanny bars from that. If you ever hear that, that's what they're referring to. But lots of different ones that are available out there. We have things like clonazepam, we have clobazam. We talked about Onfi in the seizure section is where I see that one being used a little bit more commonly. Obviously, diazepam or Valium is a very common one, Ativan, Versed. Now, there's a lot of variability in the kinetics behind these drugs. You're going to find that some of these are very water-soluble. Some of these are very lipid-soluble. What do you think that would do to their activity? Okay, so good. So permeability through the blood-brain barrier is going to be important here. You're going to find that things that are more water-soluble, they have a harder time or easier time crossing. They have a harder time crossing, right? Because they're not as lipid-soluble as some of the more lipophilic ones are going to be. You're going to find that typically the more lipophilic ones will cross over very easily and will cross back out very easily. So they have a little bit faster onset, but a little bit faster offset as well. On the other hand, though, things that are more water-soluble, what do you think that does to the elimination of the drug? Should increase it typically, right? You're going to find it's more readily eliminated through things like the kidneys, okay? A lot of these will also undergo hepatic metabolism, which is important when you think about these older patients who may have issues metabolizing them. You may see half-lives start to extend out. The other thing you're going to find is that some of these will have active metabolites. What do you think that does to the duration of action of the drug? should increase it as well. So, and again, if you go back to your beers list, if you're looking at that when you go for geriatrics, you'll see that the benzodiazepines are going to be kind of notorious for causing cognitive impairments in older patients, because again, they're depressing the entire CNS. So they have a few that they recommend being used in older patients due to the fact that these are more water soluble and they don't have active metabolites, and they're going to be more likely to be eliminated more consistently in elderly patients. So you don't have to worry as much about hepatic impairment, you don't have to worry about as much about these drugs sticking around for a long time. So that's where the acronym I use, LOTT, or L-O-T-T, and you'll find this here, is where lorazepam, oxazepam, temazepam, and triazolam. These are the shorter acting agents. These are more more consistently eliminated in patients who have organ impairment. These are the ones you prefer to use in elderly patients. That's why I started those. So you kind of remember those. If you have an older patient, you're worried about cognitive impairment, but you still need to use something for acute anxiety attacks, or if you needed to use like for seizure management, these are good ones to use. So lorazepam, oxazepam, temazepam, and triazolam. Those are the four best ones to go with for that group. Okay. But again, any of them are going to have the same mechanism. They're all going to work very similar. It's just the kinetics are going to be different between the whole bunch. Just to kind of give you a little tangent why, you know, lipophilicity and things like that make a difference. When we think about treatment for seizures, right? So we mentioned, you know, we use a lot of Ativan and Versed for seizure management. What you'll find is that lorazepam, as I mentioned, and why it's starred here, is it's more water soluble for the most part. So it takes longer for the drug to cross the blood-brain barrier. So it takes a little bit longer to kick in, but once it's there, it likes to stick around for longer. So actually what you find in some studies, you'll see that lorazepam actually has a decreased seizure recurrence in some patients than something like Versed, which is very lipophilic and will kind of cross over very easily, have its effect, and then get out very quickly. So again, I won't probably test on that exact point, but just know there are some differences here that may have actual clinical implications. And then again, for the most part, and if you worked in ER and with EMS, like Ativan is probably the number one go-to acute seizure medication, because, you know, it is very effective at helping to prevent those recurrent seizures from happening there. Although Versed is still used very commonly, you'll see that used, especially from the intranasal route, another common one you see more often. Anywho. So mentioned definitely for seizure management, acute agitation can be used as a muscle relaxant. Again, these are not great drugs to use from that standpoint because they are so sedating. You'll find that most of the muscle relaxants, we'll talk about some more of these in the ortho section a little bit later on, probably the next section of the class, that they're all going to be CNS depressants. And again, that's not great because for, you know, if you're having muscle spasms, things like that, you don't want to necessarily snow the patient, but that is an unfortunate side effect there. And then you can use them for sleep as well. Again, we had talked about all these medications that we use for sleep, and we'll talk about our Z drugs a little bit later, but what's one of the big risks you worry about with these drugs? Dependence, right? There's also, if you take dependence even further, what could that develop into? Addiction, right? So we want to keep those two terms kind of distinctly separated in your mind. So what is addiction, really? Think about addiction. So that is use despite negative impacts, right? Either from a social standpoint, from a physiologic standpoint. If they're continuing to use a drug, even though it's having these negative effects on their body, and they cannot, they don't have any, really any control of this, they have this compulsion, that would be considered an addiction, right? If I'm having to sell off, you know, my TV in order to get more access to these benzodiazepines, like that's a form of addiction, right? Or if I am, you know, not eating well because I cannot afford food because I'm trying to buy these drugs, that is a form of addiction. Dependence, on the other hand, what is dependence, really? How would you describe that? Yeah, it's basically, it's normal homeostasis. Like your body's getting used to having that effect around. It's becoming dependent on that. And when you take that away, there will be some withdrawal phenomenon, right? So I can be dependent on a drug, but not be addicted to it necessarily. And so it's important to keep those kind of terms distinctly separated, because someone can be dependent on a drug, but not be addicted, right? Those who become addicted are definitely dependent, right? So it's kind of not all inclusive from that standpoint. But so again, the body gets used to this, the GABA receptors get used to having that extra benzo effect around. So when I take this away, you're going to definitely see some withdrawal effects. And it's important to remember that, because again, you can see rebound anxiety from coming off these drugs if you're using them too frequently. Rebound insomnia if you're using them for sleep. Be careful of these withdrawal effects, because the big thing you worry about is what could happen if I have a patient who's so dependent on these benzos that had that increased GABA effect, and I withdraw that immediately, very abruptly, what could that lead to in the most severe case? Seizure, right? So I have too much glutamate activity, not enough GABA activity at that point. You can see the balance being tipped over to glutamate side, and you can see seizures. So withdrawal seizures, potentially deadly for these patients. You have to be very careful if they're on these chronically. So can I kind of refer back to the lipophilicity. High lipophilicity is going to increase or decrease that time to onset be very quick acting for the most part. And again, as you might expect, IV is going to work a lot faster than PO. Again, if it's something where they can anticipate when they're going to have an anxiety attack or something like that, PO is really good, but you know, IV is good for really kind of acute panic attacks from that standpoint. You're going to find that CYP3A4 metabolizes a lot of those benzodiazepines. So I mentioned that hepatic metabolism, but that's where you can get around this by using things like lorazepam, oxazepam, clonazepam. So those are better for patients who have maybe a drug interaction going on, either an induction inducer or inhibitor, or if they have, you know, cirrhosis, things like that. I just remember the active metabolites. Again, I'm not going to have you memorize which ones have the active metabolites or not, but just remember that LOTT, remember that's going to be better for your elderly patients because they're typically more water soluble. They avoid a lot of liver metabolism. They don't have active metabolites. Those are the big three things we like about those drugs for older patients. So adverse effects, obviously CNS suppression is going to be the biggest one, and this can be very synergistic with other CNS depressants. So what's a common thing you may see people combining benzos with? Alcohol, absolutely. I remember I had a friend in pharmacy school who said, like, when she was an undergrad, you know, they're at UF in Gainesville, and of course, you know, anyone ever been to Alachua County? Mm-hmm. Besides going out to bars, is there a whole lot to do?
No,
there's not. Very boring place outside of the college. But they would have some friends who would say, oh, well, you know, I'm just going to be a cheap date tonight. I'm just going to go ahead and just take a Xanax, and then I'll have to have like one or two drinks, and I'm good to go. Obviously, what's one of the things you see when you have CNS depressants on board? What happens to your inhibitions? They get even more resolute? Nope, they tend to go away, right? So you end up losing a lot of those. And then it's like, okay, well, I'm just going to have three or four more drinks, then five or six more, and then you're done. So be careful with that. That synergism is very, very important to watch out for because they can get very CNS depressed. You know, typically benzos, they don't cause a lot of CNS, they don't cause a lot of respiratory depression, I should say, on their own. But once you start to mix multiple drugs together, that's where you run into issues. So mixing alcohol with these, you see someone get respiratory depressed, stop breathing, or they vomit and they aspirate, can be bad news for them from a respiratory standpoint. Okay, be careful with that. Also, you can see some memory impairment. So oftentimes we will give, prior to someone going to surgery, we actually will give a benzodiazepine to them because one, it helps as an anxiolytic, it'll calm them down, but also it will start to induce this kind of amnesia. So I'm sure people are familiar with like brownouts and blackouts associated with like alcohol use. Same thing can happen here where basically they just have that memory impairment. They get this kind of retrograde amnesia that occurs here where they kind of don't remember a lot of the details of what happened. They just kind of wake up after surgery and they're fine, right? Let's see. Some people can have paradoxical excitation. Did I mention this with Benadryl in kids? Right, you give them a dose and you think it should like kind of knock them out, but they could just get bouncing off the wall. Same thing can happen for kids with benzodiazepines. You can overcome this by giving a bigger dose, but just be aware that you may give, you know, a dose of Versed to a kid and they may just all of a sudden just go crazy. It looks like they got, you know, I'm trying to think of the word, possessed by a demon or something, right? And you have to perform an exorcism. You just probably need a little bit more benzo to really chill them out. And I mentioned that withdrawal, again, it can be as minor, just a little bit of agitation, some sweating, but that rebound anxiety is going to be a big thing, which might preclude them to use or cause them to use more. But you have to try to trade it off slowly because that seizure can be potentially deadly. You got to watch out for those. Okay. Next we have buspirone or buspar. This is a non-benzodiazepine anxiolytic. This is better for kind of more chronic, long-term maintenance of anxiety. It doesn't really have any anticonvulsant properties. It's really not a CNS depressant, really. No dependence. It can be good from that standpoint. If you had a patient with like a history of substance abuse, this could be a good agent to try. Again, are the benzodiazepines controlled substances? Yes, they are all C4s. I'm trying to think if there's any exceptions. They're all C4s. Buspar, though, is one that is not a controlled substance. That can be beneficial if you had issues with that. It does have a little bit of it's kind of hit or miss as far as efficacy goes. So you may see some patients may not respond that well to it. So it's probably better of a second-line agent. If they're not really doing well with the antidepressant, you can try using this instead. And you can give it a few weeks to see kind of full efficacy. We don't know the full mechanism. It's probably having to do with something with the being a 5-HT1A agonist. So it's kind of interacting with these serotonin receptors, which is actually, when you activate this on the presynaptic neuron, that actually shuts down further serotonin release from those neurons. So that may be one way it's working, but we don't really know the full mechanism here. Just note, you will see, you know, pretty minor side effects, pretty well tolerated, and is also metabolized by CYP3A4. So watch out for those interactions. So for instance, I've had a person who was taking their Buspar for anxiety, and they said, I want to treat my depression. I'm going to take, you know, something like St. John's Wort. What could that do? And induce and inhibit 3A4. Induces, right? So St. John's Wort will induce 3A4, and that would cause these levels to go down. Now they have worsened anxiety issues, right, potentially. How about beta blockers? Anyone know where you use beta blockers for anxiety? Yeah, social anxiety. What other situations? Like, when I use it for social anxiety, like public speaking, that's a good one. I'll pop a beta blocker before I come in here talk to you guys. I think that works. Does it actually deal with the anxiety itself? Yes, it only blocks the symptoms of anxiety, right? So I remember, did I tell you about my pharmacotherapy class I had in school? I mentioned how I felt like the other students were using performance enhancing beta blockers. I was like, well, gosh darn it, I should be able to do drugs to perform better. I'm getting up there and shaking like a leaf to talk in front of these professors. But anyway, right, doesn't do anything with the anxiety the person's feeling, but it will help to do with a lot of the sympathetic effects being blocked there, right? So again, you can block things like the beta receptors on the skeletal muscle that helps with a lot of the tremor that happens there. You can block a lot of the sweating that happens. So again, when would I take a beta blocker in response if I was going to use it for, say, performance anxiety? Yep, typically like an hour before. Again, this is not something where you want to take it like the day before or right during the actual performance. Like, you want to do it about an hour before, allow the drug to get absorbed and actually kind of kick in. Now, you probably do want to recommend they take a test dose before the actual event, because again, people may experience different effects with beta blockers, may have exercise intolerance, and may have some untoward effects. You want to have them do a test dose beforehand, so that way they're not like having increased anxiety because now they feel like crap because they're on this beta blocker and they also have to do their public speaking event or whatever it happens to be. So again, be careful with those sorts of situations. Let them test it out beforehand, and then you probably write them for a few pills, have them take it beforehand, and see how they respond to it. Anywho, propranolol is probably the most common one you're going to see being used for this, but who might not that be a great agent for? Yeah, they have like reactive airway disease, asthma, probably not a good one. So you could use something like atenolol, metoprolol, any of the beta blockers would work. And then what's the other thing you have to worry about from like a diabetic patient? Yeah, it can mask the signs of hypoglycemia. So again, if they were, kind of an increased sympathetic state, they were to get hypoglycemia, those would block those responses. So you want to be careful with that as well. Good. So, they're getting like nervous before, say, for instance, a sports event, like this beta blockers may not be a good option for them, because again, that would cause them to, they need that sympathetic effect to allow their heart rate to increase and things like that. But if it's something like, public speaking or, they're a musician or something like that, the beta blockers are generally pretty good for those patients. But anyway, so again, for urgent symptoms, you can give them 2 to 4 weeks or so of a benzodiazepine to try to get them through the short term. And you also want to start off like an SSRI, SNRI in order to kind of start that kind of long-term maintenance phase there. Again, benzos should be short-term. You should only use them for as short a period of time as possible, because you worry about dependence, you worry about that tolerance that will develop to them. You want to try to avoid that if you can. If it's not urgent symptoms, if they just kind of come in and complain, like, yeah, sometimes I get really nervous about X, Y, and Z, SSRIs, SNRIs are totally fine from that standpoint to start those. No need for a benzodiazepine unless they're having really kind of acute agitation issues. Again, you can try switching around between different agents. Everyone's going to respond a little bit differently to different antidepressants, so just be careful with that. And then if they're not really getting good response, you can consider using a TCA, but due to side effects, we like to hold off on those as long as we can. Okay. Any questions on anxiety? Okay, so you guys are all chilled out now. Now it's time to bring you back up. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. So, anywho. So what is ADHD like? How do you describe it? Attention deficits, hyperactivity. I remember, how do we treat this? Adderall? What is Adderall? They're amphetamines. Does that make sense? We're giving a stimulant to someone who's already stimulated. I never really understood it myself. I don't know if I still really understand it, but apparently we're trying to like increase their level of excitation. Apparently they get kind of laser focused on one thing. Be very careful in using these for patients who are not, do not actually have the disease state. So did I ever tell you about my friend who took an Adderall before our lab final? Okay, so this was back in undergrad and we were doing A&P. You guys remember having to dissect cats? We had our lab final, we had to go through and basically identify all these structures on the cats. And so I had a friend who is kind of a little guy, but he was, it pertains to the story because the dose makes a difference here. Anyway, he's a relatively small guy, and he was had met a girl recently, as you do in undergrad, and was trying to hang out with her. And he's like, oh, I actually need to study for this test because it's actually going to be like really hard, and I could fail the whole lab. So he's like, I have a friend who I can get an Adderall from. So he took like half an Adderall. Okay. still way too big of a dose for him. Because he did not have ADHD normally, he showed up at my door the next morning because we were going to walk together to the lab. And he showed up and he's like, okay, I'm ready to go. We're going to take the test. We're going to do this. We're going to identify all this stuff. I'm like, whoa, what, are you okay? And he told me what happened. I was like, oh, okay, this is going to be fun. So we're like walking to the lab. And I mean, just total flight of thoughts. Like, could not concentrate on any one subject for any more than like, you know, 10 seconds at a time. And by the time he got into the test, actually identify the structures, he could not focus at all, and ended up bombing the whole thing, had to take the lab all over again. So, drugs are bad. Don't do drugs unless you're prescribed them. And again, this is a big deal, right? Because again, like, these drugs are very, very rife for abuse, right? A lot of people, especially in school, will sell these things. Anyone know what scheduled substances are, for the most part? Schedule 2, right? So these have the highest regulation they have on them besides, you know, not having any kind of acceptable medical use, which they'd be Schedule 1. But this is a big deal, right? So again, it's a felony to have possession of these without having a prescription. Like, this is a big deal. And so just be aware of that. Be aware that abuse is going to be really a big concern. We'll talk about some non-controlled substance options that are out there, which are good alternatives. But again, for the most part, amphetamines are the thing we're going to be treating a lot of these drugs with, or a lot of these patients with. So anyway, it's really important you set goals. So again, you know, do you want them to be able to sit in a chair for 20 minutes or do their homework in the afternoon, whatever it happens to be. Make sure you're setting goals with the parents. And focus on non-pharmacologic therapy as well. Obviously, if you can get away with that, you know, cognitive behavioral interventions, whatever. And make sure there's kind of consistent care between the different providers. Make sure that, you know, teachers are on the same page as the adults, as, you know, or the parents, I should say, whatever it happens to be. But we like drugs, so we're going to give drugs to these kids, right? So stimulants are going to be our first-line therapy for these patients. The mechanism, main things we're going to see is there's a little bit of MAOA or monoamine oxidase inhibition here, but the primary thing you're going to find with a lot of these amphetamine-based products is actually will inhibit reuptake of dopamine and norepinephrine. So we said the dopamine is really involved with what kind of pathway in the brain? The reward pathway, right? So this is why people abuse these drugs for, you know, because you can get euphoria from this. You can get really good feelings and that dopamine system gets activated. And this is why these are addictive, right? So you got to be really careful with these drugs. That's why they're C2, because that risk for addiction and abuse is very high. Anyway, so they're blocking reuptake of dopamine, norepinephrine. You also find that amphetamines will actually cause those those nerves to release some of these catecholamines as well. So again, they'll have kind of multiple mechanisms here. But basically, they're increasing that sympathetic kind of activation. They're increasing the amount of catecholamines that are in the synapse to interact with those receptors. So this will make sense when we get to a lot of the side effects associated with them. So what do you might imagine would it do to things like your heart rate and blood pressure? Should increase it, right? Should, because these are stimulants, right? They're activating that sympathetic nervous system. What do you think it would do to your pupils? Not your students, but your actual pupils. You should diet. You should see mydriasis associated with this, right? So, like, I have patients who would come in and they have overdosed on an amphetamine, you know, whether it be Molly or methamphetamine, whatever it happens to be, and they'll come up with these big saucer-looking pupils. Like, you know, it's very, very evident when you see these patients due to the stimulant effect you see with that. Now, keep in mind, there's lots of options that are available, and just because the patient does not respond well to one doesn't mean they're not going to respond to any of them. There is a little bit of interpatient variability here. So, for instance, if they failed dexmethylphenidate, try them on dextroamphetamine, see what they're going to respond to there. And then typically a lot of these are available in extended release formulations, which is another important point here as well, because what happens if I, say, have an extended release preparation and I crush it up? All that drug comes out at once, right? And so this is another common form of abuse is people will take these pills, they will crush them up, and that will liberate all the drug at once, and then they will, like, snort that, or they can eject that, or swallow it, whatever it happens to be. I see a lot of snorting of these medications. So again, be careful with that. That's why we say do not crush, do not chew for a lot of these extended release preparations, because you worry about that. Some of them will be available for IR preparations, but they need to be dosed, like, you know, 2 or 3 times a day. So what's the benefit of using a controlled release preparation? Yeah. So when do they need to be most focused? When they're in school. So you just give it in the morning. Hopefully they don't have to take anything while they're at school. They come home. Hopefully they're starting to come down off of it to some degree. And then by the time they're ready for bed, then go to sleep, right? Because you don't want to take these, you know, an extended release preparation, you know, right at dinner time, because guess what? They're going to be wired for the whole night, essentially. Okay. So here are the most commonly available ones. You have methylphenidate. And again, there's lots of different brand names that are out there. So just where you can see multiple ones here. But methylphenidate's one's seen very commonly. There's even one called Daytrona patch. You may see it being used topically for some patients. There's dexmethylphenidate. Notice here the relationship between these two. So the dex will just be the right-handed form of methylphenidate. So sometimes you'll see that. Adderall is probably the most common brand name people are kind of familiar with. This is actually a mixture of different amphetamine salts. So it'll actually be different amphetamine and dextroamphetamine. They actually will combine different ones that have different release characteristics. So you get kind of an extended release preparation out of that by mixing different ones. So you'll sometimes see those in a capsule filled with like little tiny beads, and they'll be releasing at different rates essentially that will allow for kind of an extended release. You get a good kind of nice long tail on the levels in the body seen with that one. So that's something you'll see very commonly. Has anyone ever heard of Vyvanse? Or lisdexamfetamine. This one's actually really cool because it's a prodrug. We mentioned prodrugs are what? They have to be activated in the liver before they become into their active form. And so this one actually is a prodrug that gets converted to dextroamphetamine. So this is kind of cool because if, say for instance, I wanted to abuse something like, you know, methylphenidate, it's already in the active form. If I were to crush that up and snort it, goes straight to the bloodstream, I'm good to go, right? So I get a nice high off of that, just like you'd see with cocaine or something like that. However, if I do that with a prodrug, what am I bypassing when I snort that medication? Bypass the liver. You lose a lot of that first pass effect, and thus the drug is inactive for the most part. So you don't really get as much of a high as you would see with one of these other medications. So that was kind of the original kind of thought process behind that, is okay, well, this helps to deter some of that abuse, but it's also really just a good drug in general. So I see a lot of patients, and again, being in the peds realm, you see a lot of this being used for a lot of your patients. So I see a lot of Vyvanse that's out there. Again, all of these are C2s. So again, they all have a lot of strict regulations on those. You guys remember, we talked about how prescription writing for controlled substances, can you do refills on C2s? No. Cannot, right? So how do I get around that? How do I keep my patients from coming in every single month? Yeah, you can do it for how long? Yeah, you can do multiple scripts for up to 3 months. So you can do, say, and you can write on the script itself that do not fill until this date. And the pharmacist will honor that. So basically, patient will have three scripts, you hand it over, the pharmacist will say, okay, I'm going to fill this one, I'm going to put these other two on hold, and then when you come back the next month, they will go ahead and fill that. So that is a viable option as well. Again, no more than 90 days, no refills on these prescriptions. And again, typically you want to see how the patient is going to respond to it. So you may only write for the 1 month at a time initially, and then have them come back and see how their blood pressure is doing, their heart rate, all of that, and you know, once you're kind of in more of a maintenance mode, that's when you can write for longer periods of time. Okay, so adverse effects. So reduced appetite and weight loss, you know, these stimulants, you know, similar to other weight loss medications we see, by increasing that sympathetic nervous system, that fight or flight response, you're not really hungry all that much. And so you can see a lot of weight loss associated with that, which is not a great thing for, especially for young growing kids. You know, you want them to be putting on weight because they're growing. They need that. So that could be one thing you watch out for. Certainly insomnia is one risk you can see with these meds. Some irritability, tachycardia, hypertension. So be careful with those from that standpoint. This all makes sense based on the mechanism, right? All going back to that kind of sympathetic activation. Be careful with the black box warning. Some patients are going to be more predisposed to seeing these psychotic episodes and hallucinations. You know, again, sometimes these are underlying mental health issues that may not have been diagnosed or really manifested yet. Sometimes this can be kind of an acute one-off sort of thing for these patients. So do be careful with that. Let them know that, hey, if you notice anything, you know, they start to act a little different, act a little squirrely, like, let's, you know, evaluate that and maybe switch them off to a different med potentially. And of course, the abuse and dependence is another big thing there. So again, especially not even themselves necessarily abusing it, but if they're trying to sell it off to someone else, you know, you may have, you know, so a lot of times, you know, these patients who are coming in, especially from high school and stuff like that, they may not have a prescription for it, but they can certainly definitely still be exposed to it if they're getting it from a friend. So, again, be careful, avoid these drugs typically if they have a history of drug dependence. And again, you're starting to see that more and more adult patients are being treated for ADHD because either they were kids being diagnosed with it and being treated through, or we're starting to see this adult onset ADHD that more people are being treated with, right? So that is something that's going to be more common. So if they have a history of substance abuse, you know, we'll talk about some non-controlled options available here in just a few minutes. Certainly you can have some withdrawal effects. What do you think the withdrawal effects would look like for these drugs versus like the benzos? More tired, really low energy, right? So think about that. This would not be as severe as you would see with like a benzo where you have like, you know, withdrawal seizures being a risk, but certainly they can have some withdrawal effects, you know, just like you might imagine withdrawing from cocaine, not cocaine. You see the same thing with cocaine, but withdrawing from caffeine. Oh, I have cocaine on the brain, it's weird. But, you know, same thing like withdrawing from caffeine, people usually have kind of depressed energy levels, things like that. You can see the same thing here. And then there is some concern for growth stunting. You know, it's probably minimal in most kids, but, you know, there probably should be some kind of built-in, you know, drug-free period built for the kids. So when do you think that would happen? Yeah, summertime, things like that. When the kids are maybe not in school, it's okay if they have a little bit more, they're a little bit more rambunctious. You know, maybe the parents probably want their kids heavily medicated. That's, you know, I would like to medicate my kids sometimes, but they're a little too young for that, so. Anywho, so some non-stimulant agents that are available for ADHD treatment, you have things like atomoxetine or Strattera. This is actually a selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. So it works, you know, very similar to the SNRIs, but it's more specific for norepinephrine reuptake. Again, this is another one that's approved for use in adults, so you can use this, you know, safely in someone who has abuse potential issues. But it's going to have a lot slower onset. Like, you know, the amphetamines, once they're on board, they're affecting those neurotransmitters. They're going to work pretty quick. This is going to take time, similar to what we see with the antidepressants. So give it a few weeks, see how it works. Again, no abuse potential, so it's not a controlled substance. However, you can certainly see some, you know, those effects from the increased norepinephrine. So you can see hypertension, tachycardia, you can see GI disturbances. And actually, there's a black box warning for suicidal ideation associated with it, which, again, we've already seen with a lot of our antidepressant drugs to begin with. So again, that's a very consistent amongst that group. So on the other hand, and this is kind of interesting because you can also use alpha-2 agonists for some of these patients. So again, you'll find that a lot of patients will be on, say, like an amphetamine in the morning time, and then they'll be on one of these alpha-2 agonists at the night at nighttime. We've talked about these drugs before. You remember we talked about clonidine and guanfacine. What do those typically do to like things like heart rate, blood pressure? Should lower them, right? Because these are some pathologics. These are things that are depressing for their outflow from the sympathetic nervous system. So again, these are kind of counterintuitive to how the amphetamines are working, but you know, potentially they can't help with, you know, leaving some of these symptoms. Some patients will be on these alone, but a lot of times you'll see them be on amphetamines in the morning time, and they may be on these in the nighttime to help kind of chill them out a little bit, get them a little bit more ready for sleep. So that's one thing you may see. And not as effective as stimulants, but these are also non-controlled substances. So that's another good thing if you have a patient who are worried about substance abuse. And you'll see sedation associated with these, as you might imagine. It's a little bit of depressed mental status, which should resolve in 2 to 3 weeks or so. And then you worry about hypotension, some risk for constipation. So again, first line should always be the amphetamines if they're good options. And then if not, you can use one of these non-controlled sort of formulations. Guanfacine does have a short-acting form. I'm starting to see more of the long-acting form. It's called Intuniv. So if you've ever seen Intuniv, that is a long-acting guanfacine that we'll use for those kids. This is a big one we have to worry about getting mixed up because some patients may be on immediate-release guanfacine for hypertension, or they may be on the long-acting form for ADHD. And if you mix those two forms up, you can screw up their levels in the system and cause, you know, adverse effects. You got to be really careful when dealing with immediate-release versus extended-release products, especially from the pharmacy standpoint. So again, therapy really needs to be personalized based on the goals that you're kind of setting up with the parents and the teachers. And you want to use your dosage forms dependent on what their schedule is, how likely they are to be adherent to it. You know, think about the comorbid conditions. So if they had a history of uncontrolled hypertension, and amphetamine is probably not a good option for them, right? Or history of, you know, cardiac disease, things like that. But generally, you should start with a stimulant unless they're contraindicated, and then you can move on to something like a non-stimulant, like, you know, Strattera, or consider like an antidepressant medication. Some people will respond well to that. Just depends, but you just kind of more of an add-on sort of thing. So, any questions on ADHD? Now I'm thinking about, I think I talked about the sleep drugs closer to the surgery section when we're talking about anesthesia. So we'll cover those later on. So we'll talk about our you know, Lunestas and our Ambiens and things like that later on. But just in general, they work very similar to the benzos. They're actually working on a specific subtype of GABA receptor. But just know they're going to have the same side effects, have the same tolerance issues, same abuse issues as all of your benzodiazepines would. But any questions that I can answer for you? Everyone feel like they've just received a benzo, kind of lulling them into a natural sense of sleep. Some people use my lectures for insomnia treatment, I will tell you that. Use it as you will. Okay, so this is the end of material for test one. We will do our review tomorrow, and then the test will be on Monday. So, and then your assignment is also due. Has everyone been doing those? Your prescriptions? Okay, I will start grading those on Monday after the test, and we'll see how you guys did. I'm sure it's great. All right, see you guys next time.